Good evening. Just a day after the Premier announced it's back to school for all next week, a student at one of Sydney's most prestigious colleges has tested positive to coronavirus. Chris Reason is at St Ignatius Riverview. Chris, what are school officials saying?
Yeah, good evening to you, Mark. Well, Principal Paul Hine has emailed parents confirming that a Year 7 day student has tested positive to COVID-19. He's now gone into isolation as contact tracing begins on other students. The school itself has gone into lockdown for the next 48 hours, closed as the deep cleaning process begins.
It's not because they've gone back too soon or anything like that. I think it's just in the community and, you know, it'll happen and it'll continue to happen.
Now that as state school students begin to prepare to get ready to come back to school full time from next week, that on the same day that the Sydney of City Council has announced that it's putting its parking rangers back on the beat, all adding pressure to an already stressed public transport system.
Busted. On the 247 to Taronga Zoo, the 12-person limit is ignored as numbers soared to 41. The government's new transport distancing rules look troubled.
At the end of the day, it's up to people travelling to make that call if they feel safe in that environment.
Government data shows that its new limit of 600,000 public transport trips a day has already been reached and breached by 15,000.
Have we taken an extra conservative approach on public transport? Yes, we have.
But the experts say it won't work. The worst case scenario is 400,000 more cars on the roads, blowing travel times by hours.
At the minimum, it will be three times, and at the maximum, it could be forever. The entire city is going to be a gridlock.
Forcing most to work from home until public transport restrictions lift.
But that's far from the only problem facing employees when they finally do reach the city. Once they've got off their public transport, the next challenge is to actually get into the building and up to their office.
Elevators will be a major problem. Example, the Australia Square building.
We need to maintain our 1.5 metres, yes, Chris, obviously.
2,500 employees into 16 elevators at just two per ride means long queues.
We think it could be 20 minutes, half an hour at peak time at least.
Australia's largest landlord, Dexus, asking if close contact is 15 minutes, why aren't 90-second elevator rides safe?
That's the issue we're struggling with. We're just hoping that the authorities can have a closer look and just see if it's possible to get greater movements of people.
Demands for clarity too on calls by Qantas boss Alan Joyce yesterday for planes to travel full from July. He says it's safe.
Everybody's facing in the same direction. There's a seat in front of you that acts as a barrier. And then the airflow comes from the top down to the bottom.
Government advisers seem to agree.
There are very specific engineering things that happen in relation to the ventilation on aircraft and so forth, which can make it safer than a closed room.
But the unions outraged.
We've got restaurants and pubs regulated to within an inch of their lives, yet Qantas seems to be able to dream up their own policy.
Chris Reason, 7 News.
The state government's decision to reopen regional travel from the 1st of June has created plenty of corona chaos. Some areas thrilled to be back in business, others saying they're not ready. And while New South Wales has invited interstate tourists, their leaders say thanks but no thanks. Their borders are staying shut.
The historic Batlow Hotel saved from fires that devastated the town in January.
I can't believe that shed didn't burn.
Still fighting for survival in its 100th year, but almost ready to celebrate.
I don't know that business will ever get back to normal. I think we're about to discover what our new normal is.
The owners hoping to finish renovations in time to welcome back tourists next month.
Yeah, it's a little bit quicker than I thought it was going to happen, but we'll come out of it.
Holidays back on in New South Wales from June the 1st.
North, south, west and east. Our regions are open for business.
On the south coast, phones are running hot to book homes like this one in Jervis Bay, untouched by fire, but also unavailable until now.
One woman I spoke to this morning said, I don't care how much it is, all I want to do is get out of Sydney with my kids.
The Deputy Premier had warned people to stay away from the regions until Christmas.
Well, Christmas has come early and that first shout was on me.
Most country mayors, though, will not be raising a toast.
People are frightened. They're not ready for this.
Worried local health systems could be overwhelmed and that businesses won't have enough staff.
The picture that people will get of rural areas will be a very poor one.
But a tourism industry survey found 70% of people in the regions want visitors.
Be considerate observe the rules in terms of social distancing and hand sanitizer, etc., and be good guests.
Ski fields are expected to open by July in time for school holidays.
As for interstate travel, it remains, well, up in the air. States with their borders shut, accused of harming not only their own economies, but the countries.
It will hinder the nation. It will hinder our national economic growth and activity. There's no doubt about that.
Other leaders quickly hit back.
I mean, New South Wales had the Ruby Princess. I mean, seriously? And they're trying to give us advice?
We're making our own decisions in South Australia.
We'll be making our own decisions.
And from Queensland...
We love you, but you can come a bit later.
State political reporter Alex Hart joins me now. Alex, the federal government has backed our Premier's call.
Yes, Mark, the very clear message from Canberra is that there is no medical reason why state borders should be shut. But ultimately, it is up to the respective leaders to decide when to open them. WA said today it will be many months before people here can head west. September is still the timeline for a trip to Queensland. Now, that is when overseas travel to New Zealand is expected to be allowed. And we heard today that a deal could follow very quickly after that for holidays in Fiji. Mark?
Sounds good. Alex, thank you. Art galleries, libraries and museums will open their doors on June the 1st, but cinemas and gyms will have to wait. And while restaurants have been allowed to start serving customers, owners say the rules are not only too strict, they simply don't make sense.
While they're yet to set the date, the government is making a reservation. Clubs, pubs and restaurants set to have restrictions eased further within a month. The number of patrons they're allowed to serve will double from 10 to 20, but for many, even that's not enough.
We could sit probably five tables of 10 in here, or six tables of 10. So I'm a bit unsure. They should really be doing it on perhaps square meterage size of a space.
To put things into perspective, Luke's Kitchen, the restaurant we're inside now, is 900 square meters and it sits roughly 120 people. But under the new restrictions, if you were to book a table for 10, this is how you and your friends will be seated.
10, 20 people, it just doesn't pay the bills.
There was some good news for our cultural institutions like museums, art galleries and libraries. They'll be allowed to reopen with restrictions as of June 1.
Libraries don't make much sense unless you've got people in them, so it's wonderful to be the beginning stages of being able to welcome readers back.
Eight PCYC centres across the state were also given the green light to get back to business today, but the news for some wasn't so positive.
Cinemas open on June 1?
Not yet.
What about gyms?
Not yet.
We could definitely service 30, 40, 50 clients through social distancing and still not put anyone in the way of harm.
For now, the health advice is clear. Opening on June 1 just won't work out. Peter Fegan, 7 News.
Australia's retailers have suffered their biggest slump ever, a massive hangover from the hoarding we saw in March. Network finance editor Gemma Acton joins me now. Gemma, what more can you tell us?
Well, Mark, a survey from the Bureau of Statistics shows food and grocery stores took the biggest fall last month. Huge demand for non-perishable foods in March drove a surge in retail sales. That, however, was reversed in April with a 17.9% fall worth $5.4 billion, the biggest monthly plunge ever. This as cafes, restaurants and retailers all closed their doors. Online sales, however, bucked the trend, making up 10% of total sales. Meanwhile, retailers are hoping for a recovery of sorts in May. Myer today announced it's reopening another 9 stores this Friday, including Blacktown, East Gardens and Charlestown in Lake Macquarie. Mark.
OK, Gemma, thank you.